get a chance to say that too already. Joy to the world, the Lord has indeed come. Amen. That's what it's all about, isn't it? That's why we celebrate. We're here today to rejoice in the fact that the Lord is come. And we're glad that you are here this morning to celebrate with us. As we go to prayer this morning, we have several prayer requests that are really important requests. Two of our members are in the hospital with COVID, and we want to pray for Michelle and for Deb. Debbie, they are in need of our prayers, and some of this is serious, so let's really continue to pray for these requests. Asking all to continue to pray for Gary. He's not going to be able to be with us in worship for about 6 months because of his protocols, and he misses being here, but we want to pray for him and continue to pray that the treatments he takes following his surgery will be sufficient. Right now, he is cancer-free, but there is a 50-50 chance. Yes, praise God for that. There's a 50-50 chance that it could come back, but I say a 50-50 chance it won't. And we're going to just trust God for that better 50, amen? So let's remember these of our fellowship and pray for them today. And also, as we pray today, lift up the country of Indonesia. As we pray around the world for our persecuted church, this is very, very important, I think, for us to continue to pray for them. So join with me in prayer, if you would. Father God, we thank you today for the privilege we have to be in your house. Thank you for sending Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, that you came. Thank you that we can celebrate this birth of the Christ child at this season of the year. Thank you today that we can rejoice in the fact that you came. Joy to the world. Today we pray for our world. We pray for our country. We pray for our community. We pray for our church. We pray, Lord, you be with every need that's represented here. We lift it up in a couple names. For Michelle, we pray you touch her today. Just help her in a special way. For Debbie, we pray that you be with her. And for Gary, we ask you to touch his needs, Lord, and encourage him both physically and spiritually today as he continues to recover. We also pray today that you would be with every need here. Lord, we pray for every family that's been touched by COVID. There are so many that are either coming out of quarantine right now or cannot be with us today because of quarantine. You know all these needs. We ask you to touch them, Lord, in Jesus' name, and protect them from any further debilitation from this virus. We pray for those in authority over us. We pray that you would be with those making decisions, even about this coronavirus. We hear so many things being said on a national level and some conflicting things, and there's disagreements and all these things. We pray, Father, that we might just get clear picture and do what we need to do, that you might have your way in this way of physical needs and the health of our people. We pray for our armed services, wherever they are around the world, for their protection. We pray for our missionaries. We pray for Christians, wherever they are, both here in our own community and other churches. Here in our own church, we pray, Lord, for those in other countries, other cultures. Pray especially for those being persecuted for their faith. And in Indonesia, we pray for those who are being abused verbally by family members because they became Christians. Those who get isolated because of that, Father, we pray that you would be with them today, and we give you thanks for what you're going to do. Now, Lord, we come to celebrate you, and so today as we do that, we pray for everyone who participates, that we might lead and that you might allow us to encounter you in this place today, and we'll give you thanks and praise for all that you do in Jesus' name. Amen. Again, we welcome you to the Church of Genesis this morning. I'd like to enlarge a bit on comments that I made earlier about COVID. I really want to encourage us to be careful. This thing has gone on for a long time, and we all hope to be over by now. I talked to a pastor this week, and he said, I'm just ready for my people to stop fighting. People in the church arguing over it. We have people on one side who believe that this thing's nothing but a head cold, and other people who believe it's something to be fearful of. And I'm not fearful of COVID, but many of our people, myself included, have had it. We have experienced it. Several of our people are not here today because they are going through it right now. And so please be careful. We're not instituting any mandates. We've got enough of that coming from Washington, D.C. But you know, if you need a mask, they're provided here. Continue to sanitize. Continue to try to keep careful distance if you need to. Whatever. I know some are vaccinated, some of you are not. This is just a bunch of confusion in many, many ways. So please be careful. That's what I'm asking you to do right now, is be careful to the next while to see what happens with all of this. I don't believe that this new variant is as serious as others would have been, and yet more people are being affected by it. That's the thing, more people. We're just seeing every day someone else is coming down with it, and some of our people have been hospitalized. You know, when we first went through this in 2020, nobody was hospitalized from our church. We escaped that. And now we see people on oxygen, they're in the hospital, and coupled with pneumonia, and all these different things. Please be careful. Please be careful. Saying that, we also have been wanting to have people who will greet each other when they come to church. And I know that not everybody's comfortable doing that yet. But if there are people in the church, or you're here and you'd like to be at least stand in the door and welcome people as they come into the building, we don't do that right now because of COVID. But don't have to shake their hand, you don't have to touch them and hug them, but we would like to have people that would be willing to just say, welcome to the church, we're glad you're here today. If you are a person who would like to do that, please see Jamie Avery after the service, or put it on your tear-off sheet, say, I'm willing to do that, and we'll kind of get that back in operation. And if nobody's volunteering to do that, that means we're not ready to do it yet, right? And we'll wait, and we'll put it off a little bit longer. The one thing that I've said from the very beginning, March 2020, when we had this time where we had to close the church for a while, I stand here every Sunday, and I look out over the congregation, and I see people. I see a lot of people out here that we love dearly, and some of you are not as young as you used to be, and you know what? I don't ever dread having to stand in a pulpit in this church and look out over the congregation and say, so-and-so used to sit back there, but they aren't with us anymore because of COVID. I don't want to ever have to do that. And so, again, let's be careful. Amen?
Amen.
Now we're going to receive our offering and ask as we give, and we give unto the Lord. Father, we thank you for the way you provide for our needs. You provide spiritually and emotionally. You strengthen us in many, many ways. You also provide for us physically and temporally. And we're here today because we have the ability to provide for us. Some have more, some have less, but we're here. You clothe us, you feed us, you shelter us. And we recognize that every good and perfect gift comes from the Father of lights. Today I ask you to bless this offering as we give back to you a portion of what you've given to us believing that it's yours already, asking you to take it and use it to further the kingdom through this local church here at home and around the world through missions, we pray. In Jesus' name.
But this Christmas morning, I Oh, come, let us adore. before I begin, I just wanted to say something. This song is a new song, and it's very profound. It has a lot of typology in it, I might say. But I was just sitting there thinking when our sister sang. You know, the Lord appeared to two different types of people. One were the angels. Where the angels appeared to the shepherds. And he said, "I bring you glad tidings of great joy, which shall be to all the people." And they saw angels. They didn't take anything but their worship to the manger. But the Magi, the three kings that came from the east, all they got to see was a star. But it meant a lot to them, and they brought the rich presents that kings with. And so what we have is glad tidings of great joy unto all people. And that's such a wonderful thing. So the name of this song is Welcome to Our World.
Watch this video this morning, please.
I mean, can you even imagine what it would have been like to have been born in a manger?
Yeah, I know. I wonder whatever happened to baby Jesus.
Well, he grew up, you knew that, right?
Yeah. Wait, from the Christmas story is the same guy as the adult walk on water Jesus?
Yes.
It's the same guy.
Yeah.
Sorry, I just never put those two concepts together before. Well, I wonder whatever happened to him.
You know about the whole cross thing, right?
That's the same guy? Come on. Baby Jesus was the Jesus on the cross.
What? I mean, there's some time in between. But yeah, he was born and he grew up and taught people. And then he died on the cross. And then he rose again. And now he lives in our hearts.
Wait. That's the same guy. The Jesus that lives in our hearts. I guess sometimes, you know, I forget to put two and two together.
I guess.
It's almost as if we need to stop seeing Christmas as an isolated event and see it as more of a continuous story of our salvation.
Yeah, actually, that's exactly right.
This is the same thing.
Same guy. Yesterday was Christmas Day. Geez, you forgot. But Christmas is not over. I heard on the news this morning that they're already collecting Christmas trees. People are discarding. I'm going, wow. It's over by just yesterday, and they're it's like amazing to me that people do that so quick. Christmas is not over. In fact, it's just beginning. I hope you haven't taken down all your decorations yet, because Christmas lasts 12 days. Now, you've heard the song, 12 Days of Christmas. You either like the song or you are annoyed by it. The repetitiveness and all the different lyrics and all the things. But Christmas continues. Now that the deadlines that we have imposed on ourselves to cook and to bake and to wrap all those gifts and to travel from here to there are past, perhaps we can settle in for these next 12 days. And reflect and enjoy why Jesus came. Why did Jesus come? What difference does it make that Jesus came at Christmas? Max Lucado recounts that his dad told him and his brother, "Boys, Christmas is about Christ." That kind of sums it up, doesn't it? But ponder what difference that makes. Max Lucado goes on to say that because Jesus came, God knows what it is like to be human. When I talk to him about deadlines or long lines or tough ties, he understands. He's been there. He's been here. Because of Bethlehem, I have a Savior in heaven. Christmas begins what Easter celebrates. The child in the cradle became the king on the cross. And because he did, there are no marks on my record. Just grace. His offer has no fine print. Christmas is about our precious Christ. Today we're not going to consider the Christmas story. We're not going to talk about the Christmas narratives. We're not even going to read the scriptures that related to the prophecies about the birth of Christ. We've done that over the past 4 weeks of Advent, and we read those Friday night at our Christmas Eve service. Today's a message that may not even seem like a Christmas message, but it is. And if you have your Bibles with you today, if you want to turn to the Gospel of Luke, Luke chapter 19, I'm going to read the first 10 verses of Luke 19 as we consider the question, why did Jesus come? What is it all about? Luke puts it this way. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was wealthy. He wanted to see who Jesus was, but because he was short, he could not see over the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and said to him, Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today. So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter, he has gone to be the guest of a sinner. But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor, and if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount. Jesus said to him, today, salvation has come to this house, because this man too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. In Luke's Gospel, we have the account of a man named Zacchaeus, a short, curious, and hated tax collector. And Jesus used his encounter with Zacchaeus to proclaim why he came to earth. And we would do well to identify with Zacchaeus as well. Sinners who can decide to connect with Jesus and be transformed. Jesus came for sinners like you and me. That's why he came. Now let's unpack this narrative that Luke records for us. Zacchaeus was a man. We're told in the passage of Scripture that he was wealthy. He was a tax collector. He was short. And certainly he wanted to see Jesus. He was curious. And so he wanted to see who Jesus was. He heard about him. And he heard that Jesus was passing by. And so he wanted to see who he was. You and I today, we cannot seek out Jesus in bodily form. We can't go to a place where he's going to show up and be. We can't go like to a concert or to a place where Jesus is the guest or maybe even the feature. But we can and we should seek him in all that we do. Someone has taken the phrase about the wise men that we'll be talking about in a couple of weeks were people who sought after Jesus. They sought him. And someone has kind of made this little phrase, wise men still seek him. We need to seek Jesus. We need to seek after him. And so Zacchaeus made a significant effort. There's different places in Scripture where we read about how people went beyond, above and beyond to try to get to Jesus and get people to Jesus. And Zacchaeus was no different. Somehow he ascertained where Jesus was going to be. He may have heard that Jesus was going to be coming down this road at this time, and he wanted to see him. And so he went to that place, and he saw the crowd coming. He saw the people walking with Jesus, and it was kind of like a parade. You've been to parades, as we all have, and sometimes you try to get a good place in the parade route to see the parade. Have you ever been to a parade where you couldn't see the parade? All you could see the back of somebody else's head? There's no fun, is it? And this was Zacchaeus' problem. He couldn't see over the people. And I can picture him just kind of jumping up in the air and trying to see. I want to see Jesus. He wanted to see this person that he was curious about. And so he overcame the obstacle of not being able to see Jesus. He overcame the obstacle. We have obstacles to overcome, don't we? Sometimes we're hindered by what we want to see. We were hindered, perhaps, or schedules will get in the way, and people might discourage us, and we might be wanting to be where Jesus is, and then something happens. Over the years, I've heard many people say, you know, I really made up my mind, I'm going to start going to church again. I'm going to go on this particular Sunday. And you know, they wake up that morning and the car doesn't start. Or they wake up that morning and they don't feel well. They're sick and they got fever and they can't go to church. And there are obstacles that sometimes prevent us from seeing Jesus. Since Zacchaeus could not see over the crowd, he ran ahead. He ran ahead of the crowd. He ran ahead of all of them and he climbed up in a sycamore tree, as the song goes. The Savior for to see. His effort did not go unnoticed. It was not something that Jesus missed out on. Because it tells us in the narrative that Jesus looked up and spoke to him. No one is overlooked by Jesus. Take great comfort in that. You and I are never overlooked. Our efforts to see him, our efforts to seek after him are never overlooked. They never go unnoticed. They are not for naught. We go to see Jesus and seek after him. He does not miss that. If you're here today and you're struggling through something in your life, and many are, you see, we don't know when people come to church and they carry the baggage they carry. We don't know what's on your mind. We don't know. You may come in with a smile on your face. You may put up a front. You may have all kind of facades out there that nobody's going to get and see the real you. But you're really hurting inside. And some may be here this morning in that situation. If you're here today and you're struggling with something, I want to tell you today that Jesus doesn't miss it. Jesus notices where you are. Jesus notices what you're going through. Jesus looked up into the tree. I wonder if Jesus maybe saw a little bit of humor in all this. He's walking down the street. The disciples are all gathering around him. And crowds are on the side. And people are hollering. And whatever goes on in those little ventures that he went on. But as he was going down the road, he looks up there and he sees this little guy in a tree. Hanging onto a branch. And he stopped. He stopped. And he looked up. And he invited himself to Zacchaeus' house. You know, notice that Zacchaeus did not invite him to his house. Zacchaeus, like many of us, might have felt unworthy to invite Jesus to his house. But Jesus passed by that as well. He looked up and said, Zacchaeus, come down right now. Come out of that tree. I am coming to your house today. He invited himself to spend time with Zacchaeus. Jesus has been inviting us every day to spend time with him. Oh, we get busy. We have so many things going on, and we get to the end of the day, we say, oh, I want to spend time with Jesus today, but I just got overwhelmed by all the things I'm doing. And Jesus says, I'm coming to your house. I'm with you. Spend some time with me. Connect with me. And so, Zacchaeus welcomed Jesus as a guest in his home. Zacchaeus took him up on that self-invite. Sure, Jesus, come on in. Come on to my house. I'm looking forward to this. Jesus connected with Zacchaeus. Kind of use that terminology a lot today, that when we are with people and there's a common ground and the things happen, we say that they connect with each other. And Jesus had a connection here with Zacchaeus. They went home together. It struck me that the one who couldn't see over the crowd now is walking with Jesus side by side. Can you picture the parade? Here's Jesus coming down. Go back a little bit. Rewind. Jesus coming down this road. Disciples are around him. People are on the sidelines, want to see him. People are trying to get a glimpse of him. Zacchaeus could not. He went through all this thing we just talked about. He couldn't get near Jesus. But then when Jesus stopped and says, come on down, Zacchaeus, I'm going to come to your house. Zacchaeus kind of walks right up and gets right next to Jesus. And now the rest of the way, they walk together. He didn't have to strain to see him. He is right beside him. He is right next to Jesus. It reminds me of that song, the beloved song of many, that goes like this. I won't sing it, I'll just recite it. And he walks with me and he talks with me. And he tells me I am his own. That's what Jesus will do. That's what Jesus wants to do. He wants to walk with us and talk with us. He wants us to be with him. He doesn't want us to be away from him, only seeking but finding. In the book of Revelation, chapter 3, verse 20, Jesus said this. Said, here I am, behold, if you're looking at the King James Version. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person and they with me. I'm coming to your house, and I'm knocking at the door. And if you just open the door, I'm going to come in, and we will connect. We will have time together. We will be able to be together, not only physically, but spiritually. And Jesus had an impact on Zacchaeus' life. Surely, Zacchaeus was overwhelmed. Surely Zacchaeus was thrilled with what came about as a result of his effort of finding where Jesus was and going to see him and trying to see him and overcoming the obstacle of being so short he couldn't see. He climbed up the tree and got to see Jesus, and Jesus saw him, and all this happened, and Jesus made an impact on him. When we see Jesus for the right reason, he will make a tremendous impact on our life. I'm not talking about seeking Jesus because I don't want to go to hell. These are called that, you know, fire insurance. We want to escape hell. We want to get out of hell free card. And sometimes we go to church and we seek out God in that way, just what we can get out of it. Maybe if I seek God, he'll take care of my financial problems. If I seek God, maybe he will heal my loved one. If I seek God, maybe he'll do this, maybe he'll do that. And if God doesn't do those things, what often happens is people say, I tried it, and it didn't work, and they walk away. That's the wrong reason to seek out God. That's the wrong reason to seek out Jesus. But when we seek Jesus for the right reason, he will make a tremendous impact on our lives. He will transform us.
He will take away all of that sin and darkness. He will wash us and make us white as snow. He will make a difference in my life, in your life, and there should be a noticeable difference. A person who comes to Christ and encounters him and connects with him in the right way is a changed person. Behold, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creature. A new creature. The old things have passed away. Behold, all things become new. That's what happens when we connect with Jesus. But, as often happens in this narrative, others are being critical. Others are being critical. Jesus himself was accused of associating with sinners. It says in the NIV that they were muttering. Muttering, isn't that something? There are these people muttering about Jesus. Look at him. Look what he's doing. But no. You know, he's going to the sinner's house. Can we be guilty of that? Of course. You see, if Christians today do something that's not just the way we think they ought to do them, oh my goodness, we get all bent out of shape. We sometimes even criticize the way people come to Christ. If they didn't walk the aisle like we walked the aisle, if they didn't say the same words we said, if they didn't get saved in a church, if they didn't get saved in a camp meeting, well, they're not really saved. You know, I don't know where the people get that, but you know, that's the way people are. People get their heads in the wrong place. And these people were critical. And they really missed the impact of what was taking place. What was happening in that sinner's house was transformational. What was happening in that tax collector's home was something that was remarkable, miraculous. You never know what's going to happen when people encounter Jesus. You never know. Others may misjudge our motives and even our actions, but what is spiritual transcends it all. And so the third thing we see here in this passage is that Zacchaeus received salvation. He received salvation. That's the word that Jesus used, so we're going to focus on that a minute this morning. You see, I've already mentioned that he was transformed. Zacchaeus didn't merely repeat a prayer or do lip service. He wasn't just caught up in the celebrity notion that he got to spend time with Jesus. He sought him out and he got to walk down the road with him and he got Jesus in his house. Can you imagine when Jesus left? What would you and I do? Guess who was at my house today? He sat right there. It's like the old George Washington slept here. Wow. We got to touch royalty. We got to touch celebrity status. That's not it. When Jesus left, Zacchaeus didn't brag about the fact that he got to be with Jesus. It wasn't even that because he was a tax collector, he was basically hated by other people. But his life was changed. And we know it was changed because he said to the Lord, unprovoked, Lord, I am giving half of all my possessions to the poor. Now let me clarify for a moment. That is not a directive of Scripture. Don't take that today, that you have got to go home because you're saved and tally up your net worth and give half away to the poor. That's not what we're saying. It's what Zacchaeus did. This is descriptive of what Zacchaeus did because it's what God had placed in his heart to do.
God will place other things in your heart, my heart, maybe. Maybe he'll say, give this away. But he may also just say, do this. And go here. Reach out to that person or something of that nature. No doubt what Zacchaeus had, and tells us he was very wealthy, was probably because he got it in a crooked manner. Ill-gotten gain. The tax collectors in Jesus' day, they had the freedom under the Roman government, supported by the law. They were able to exact more money out of people than what they owed. So they had to pay their tax to Rome. They had to support the local government. But then the tax collector could say, how about some for me? And they had to pay it. You need some things? You're low on cash? Well, do you collect the taxes? Just say, give me some more here. None of us like paying taxes, and April comes around fast enough when we have to do that income tax return, and we see how much money that the government took out of our paycheck. Say, wow, what I could have done with that. And then we get angry, and we say, I shouldn't have to do this all night. But just imagine if the system was such that after we paid what we due, that the government could say, now, I want a few extra $1,000 for doing your tax return, or whatever the case may be. You know, he has to follow the illustration. But not only did he give half the possession to the poor, but he promised to pay back whom he cheated four times over. And so he knew those he cheated, and became aware of that. He not only just gave him back what he took, but he gave him four times what he took. That means there was a significant transformation. But we come to the end of the story. When we come to the very end of this narrative, we see what really happened. And I think it's really worth honing in on right now as we close. Jesus said, salvation has come to this house today. Salvation has come to this house. Why? Because Zacchaeus connected with Jesus, Jesus connected with Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus was transformed and backed it up with his action. And we have this verse that we've often quoted and we see so many times, that the Son of Man, Jesus Christ, came to seek and to save the lost. The baby in the manger is the same guy as the walk on water Jesus. And the walk on water Jesus is the same guy that went to the cross for you and for me. The same Jesus who came at the first Advent that we've just celebrated is the same Jesus who is coming at the second advent, the second coming, when he is going to come back and take his people to be with him one of these days. There's a difference of opinion on how it's going to happen. There are different views about the rapture and all of that kind of stuff. I'm not going to take time to go into that at all. But one of these days, we're going to go, and we're going to be with him forever. Paul said, we will be caught up to meet him in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. That is a promise to you and me. We who have accepted Jesus as our personal Savior. Not because we go to church, not because we've joined the church, not because we serve on a committee, not because we are on a church board, not because we are a pastor of a church. You know, there are pastors of churches who will not be in heaven. Oh, did I say that? Yes, I did. There are people who are in the profession that I am in that have never trusted Christ as our Savior, and that boggles the mind, but it's true. There's no guarantee by
our status in life, that we're going to make it to heaven. The only reason why we're going to heaven is that Jesus Christ came to this earth. He loved us. And while we were yet sinners, Scripture says he died for us. He went to the cross. And he bore our sins on the cross. And because he bore our sins on the cross, we have the hope of eternal life. We have forgiveness of sins. You know, the Bible tells us, really, all it takes is to confess that Jesus is Lord. Now, let me clarify that. It doesn't mean we just say, oh yeah, Jesus is the Lord. No, that's not enough. If we confess Jesus is the Lord, you know, many people would do that. But if we confess Jesus as my Lord, your Lord, if he is the Lord of your life, if he is the one who controls you, if he's the one who affects your decisions, he is the one who, when it comes right down to it, you say, you know what? Not my will, but Lord, your will in my life. If we confess Jesus as Lord of my life, and Paul says if we believe in our heart that it's God who raised him from the dead, and the baby in the manger grew up, he walked on water, yes, he went to the cross, yes, this Jesus is the one that God raised from the dead. And on Easter morning, in a few weeks, we're going to celebrate another day like that. When we celebrate the resurrection, Jesus came out of that tomb. He rose again. And he lives today. The decision is ours, though. He did it all. He's done everything that he needed to do. He really can't do anything else. He's done it. He's paid the price. But if we confess him as Lord, and if we believe in our heart that God raised him from the dead, we shall be saved. But as many as received him, to them gave he the right to be called children of God, even those who believe on his name. How about it? How about it? Would you bow your heads with me right now? Let's bow your heads. On this Sunday after Christmas, as we are here still celebrating a great time, our lives. I wonder if there's someone here this morning who is not sure. Maybe you've gone through all the motions. Maybe you've gone through all of the time of being a church person, but you've never really said to the Lord, Lord, forgive me. I confess you as my Lord. I believe God raised you from the dead. Save me. I want to pray for you. Because if you're here this morning in that situation, you don't need to be. In fact, you don't need to leave here. No one needs to leave here, and I hope nobody would leave here. Not knowing that you know that you know that you know that you have eternal life. And if we should die today, tomorrow, by natural causes or disease or by accidents, or if the Lord should come back when we least expect it, there's no doubt in our hearts, no doubt in our minds, that we are going to spend eternity with him. If you would like me to pray for you, I'm not going to embarrass you. I'm not going to ask you to come forward. But if you would like to be remembered in this prayer, just lift your hand and put it down. I'd like to pray for you. Is there anyone here today? Yes. Thank you. Anyone else?
could be the greatest Christmas ever for anybody to come to know Jesus in a definite, sure way. Pray with me if you would. Father God, I thank you this morning for speaking into our lives, for connecting with us in this time. Thank you for those who responded to this invitation. Lord, give them the assurance. Let them know that you have come into their lives, forgiven their sins. Help them know that they have a home in heaven. We thank you for that assurance that John wrote in Scripture, inspired by the Holy Spirit, that he wrote these things that we may know that we have eternal life. We know. We know. And we thank you for that. In Jesus' name.
Service, we're just going to close with this hymn, "I Heard the Bells on Christmas Day."
Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.